Good evening. My name is Hortense Crozier-Perfect, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. At this time, I would like to introduce our dean, Dr. Marlon Love, and our president, Dr. Christopher Williams. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the word or son, a superincorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Nine, to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10th, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. I will dedicate the prayer this evening. We will have a musical lesson and a scripture, and the scripture lesson will be read by Dr. Marlon Love. Let's bow our heart and our mind in a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, thank you for keeping us in this gospel. Thank you for the teachers that come forth and let you be their guide in giving us this true gospel, which was a mystery, but is now made manifest to us. All these things we ask in your name. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
To the right is the law of the Spirit. To the left are the works of the law. I know which side you're on. You're still hanging on to that cross. But you gotta know the difference to know where to stand. Worship Him in spirit and His purpose and plan. In other words, my friend, you gotta be on His right. Still working hard to get to heaven, but it ain't working cause you do that sin. The law of the Spirit of life in you is the only way you can get in. So put down that wafer, put down that wine, they're long out of season, pass through their time. In other words, my friend, you gotta be on His right hand. There's been a change. Spiritual age, there's been a change. The spiritual is in, the physical is out. What Yahweh says, what Yahweh likes, is really all that counts. You gotta understand, there's been a change. There's been a change. Don't go get in that water, it won't clean that inner man inside. Tell you what you do, you get His Spirit in you. You got yourself eternal life. Yahweh doesn't like those carnal things you do. You deny the Son, the one who died for you. In other words, my friend, you gotta be on His right hand. Cause there's been a change. We're living in a spiritual age. There's been a change. The spiritual is in, the physical is out. What Yahweh says, what Yahweh likes, is really all that counts. You gotta understand, there's been a change. There's been a change. There's been a change.
Unfamed, from which
from which some have swayed, have turned aside unto vain janglings, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully. Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjured persons, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, according to the glorious evangel of the blessed Elohim, which was committed to my trust. And I thank Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior, who has enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and an injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Elohim was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Yahshua the Messiah. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all exceptions, that Yahshua the Messiah came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit, for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me first Yahshua the Messiah might show forth all longsuffering, for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to live forever, everlasting. Now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise Eloah, be honor and glory forever and ever. This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare, holding faith and a good conscience, which some have put away concerning faith have made shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexandra, whom I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. I have read 1 Timothy, the first chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Eunice Bryson. At this time, it is an honor and a privilege to introduce our dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good evening, class. It's good to be here. Good to have another opportunity to learn about the things which we've been shown and the things that we've received according to the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, which is the gospel by which we as a school are endeavoring to learn. We want to endeavor to learn something that we don't know about or didn't know about until coming into this gospel. I have a lot of things on my mind, yet I'm going to be mindful that this gospel is, that we in this gospel are not against people. Jehovah's Witnesses, any other denomination you want to pull out the hat, the people are not the problem. problem sometimes, or all the time, has and is becoming the doctrine. The doctrine. There's only one doctrine. Grab me Romans 1 and 16, if you would.
Romans 1 and 16.
Mm-hmm.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
That's all. He's not ashamed of the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Not our own, not his own. And there's one gospel. You see. 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. Go ahead and read.
1 Corinthians 15.
1 Corinthians 15.
You locked us out.
Is there
any Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you.
See, Saul says the gospel, not gospel singular or plural. Okay? Mm-hmm. And the gospel is a gospel of reconciliation, to reconcile a person unto Yahshua. You see? Why has it be reconciled under Yahshua? It becomes the question. Why can't it be knowing who I am? Or knowing who you are? You see? We come to learn about Yahshua Messiah and the gospel, or glad tidings, some might want to say. And there's a prescribed way of doing it. Dr. Kinley had a divine vision and revelation. We say he had a panoramic vision and a revelation. Panoramic meaning he saw what Moses saw and he saw what John saw. You see? And that there was nothing outside of there of what John saw. Meaning that John turned and he's turning and looking back at Elohim, clothed, you follow? And that Moses, when he got his divine vision, he saw Elohim walking away, walking down through the ages and dispensations. We read in Romans 1, 19 and 20. Just go ahead and pick up from, reread John 1, 16 and take it down from there. Romans 1:19.
Yeah.
It started at 16.
Romans 1:16.
Mm-hmm.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
Now, this is the gospel that Saul received. Okay? Read.
For it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation.
See, that's the power unto salvation, not your testimony. Not how you see it, that it makes sense to you. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You can't make these events in time as fables to suit your personal problems. That's what the world does. They'll grab scripture and verse, and they'll try to line it up to their situation. You read it all the time. They got books upon books. If you're sorrowful, go read this verse and that verse. If you're depressed, go read this verse and that verse.
Yeah.
If you're wanting Go read this verse and that verse. They love Job. Job endured. The people want to be like nice, like Moses. Yes, you have a question. So let's get it on the mic. Because, see, we come to teach. I got it, Doc. We come to teach. We come to preach the gospel unto the world. We got mics. We got cameras. Not a problem. Here.
Isn't it possible that there are scriptures that can give us comfort and peace, though? Because you read some of those scriptures, some of the Psalms, and I don't know what else. They're beautiful words, some of them. I mean, I realize that there's stories that with are bloody and ugly.
Grotesque.
Yeah, mean. Yahweh is mean because look what he did to these people, or what he had the Israelites do to the
Philistines.
Yeah, whatever, all this war and killing babies and all all this destruction and all this stuff. But yet, then there's the prayers and the
nice
music
things.
And all. Yeah, they're beautiful. And why can't those things be used to give us peace, the words? Why can't we use those words to tell other people, to give them a peace, some sort of peace during their time of depression or, sadness,
To help them get through that situation.
Yeah.
To bring some solace and some comfort to their heart.
Yeah, I know that that's not going to save a soul. It's the end.
But you know that's not going to save a soul.
Because we're taught that.
What are we doing here if we're not saving souls?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm talking about telling the person, read this scripture for your depression or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got the whole world to go to church.
Yeah.
Go to church and get that. If that's going to bring you solace and comfort.
I know, that's what I'm
saying.
I'm saying that is not going to give you salvation. It's
true.
It's knowing and coming to learn, understand, and know Yahweh.
And that's what I just said.
Yeah.
And I said that that's just giving a person a chapter and verses to get through their personal situation for the time being is not unto salvation.
Yeah, it's not unto salvation, but it can be used to give them comfort. I thought that you were saying that why bother telling them to, if it's not going to really help them? Anyway.
No, that's fine.
Maybe we're saying the same thing.
I said it. I said you can go to church too to get that.
Yeah, that's true.
No, you can say that's true, right?
True.
That's what the church, and that's all I was expressing.
So
that they know the Bible much better than I do. Oftentimes, quote chapter
can
and verse.
Say something.
Sure. Go ahead, Hartman.
If you're reading those scriptures because you're depressed and you think they're going to give you comfort, if you don't have an understanding of what it means, what kind of comfort is it going to bring you?
You asking a question to me? Hartens?
Not to the person that...
Oh. Well, she realizes that there are Psalms, there are the Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. We read it the other day. What's the most sorrowful time when a loved one has passed away? And they'll run to Ecclesiastes. We talked about it the last class. I'm not trying to belittle the scriptures. I'm not belittling the scriptures. I'm not saying that they by themselves, chapter or a verse here or two, not going to prick a person to have comfort. That's fine. They can read the Bible all day themselves, and people find that. But to understand the purpose of Yahweh, they can't find it. Ever learning and ever coming into the consciousness. You need to find that one. Ever learning and never coming into the consciousness.
Yeah.
See? They ever learning, give them chapters and verses to appease and to soothe their problems, not a problem. And they get uplifted in their situation. It appears that they've overcome a situation. But inevitably, what happens when we go to church? They go to church. They get the sermon, the music, everything gets uplifted. They say good, positive words. They're leaving all the mayhem behind, giving a person a sense of hope. But after Monday and Tuesday roll around, they're back down there tearing and wondering what's going on. They have nothing to feed on. They have nothing to chew on. Sunday is like a bunch of ho-hos and donuts and Twinkies, eating a bunch of sugar, getting a real good high, and then after Monday coming around, they get that drop. They ain't got nothing to read. They're looking for a man to bring them something to get them up and lifted out of their consciousness, their state of depression, their state of whatever it is. That's what giving them Psalms and the pleasancies of Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. They have a whole group of people at the funeral and they're reading half of Ecclesiastes. They won't go into the fourth chapter of Ecclesiastes. They're satisfied of what Ecclesiastes talked about. Everything happens under in a season. We know that. We're aware of that. But then we're all down in here and we have to be ignorant of what salvation is. What were you reading there?
Oh, did you want ever learning?
Romans.
Ever learning and never able to come into the knowledge.
Yeah, go up there. What verse are you at?
2 Timothy 3:7. Mm-hmm. I can go 6.
That's fine.
For of this sort are they.
Oh, go up. What, yeah. We'll find out what sort this is. Find out what sort this is.
5. Having a form of the wish of.
Going up again to another one.
Yep.
Just start at 1.
Right. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come.
That's where we're at. That's where everybody claimed to say we're in perilous times. Mm-hmm. Read.
For men shall be lovers of their own selves.
I said in the beginning when I started this dialogue, this discourse, that your testimony is not going to help you. Our own personal testimony is like a snowflake. Everyone's different. Like a thumbprint. Everyone's different. The iris in your eyes, you can go with the electronic scans or whatever you want to do. Everybody's different. But there's a principle. The manifestations change. Some light skin, some olive tone, some female, some male, some hermaphroditic. Some got a whole lot of different characteristics, manifestly so. Them were men, meaning everybody. I'm putting all that in a nutshell, men and women. And they'll be lovers of their own selves. Mm-hmm. Reading the scriptures and reading what's going to appease them to get them over their situation. That's what the churches do. They got psalm books and prayer books for every situation you can imagine. Yeah. We not here pelling that. I know that Ontario is not supposed to be. I've never done. Keep reading.
Covetous, boasters.
You know what covetous mean? Greedy. Keeping the things to themselves. Not being able to preach or teach to anybody else other than their own little group. Read.
Proud, blasphemers.
Blasphemers. What's blasphemy? Saying things that's not in the that's not according to the gospel. Saying things that are not. I'm going to recite one. But go ahead and read.
Disobedient to parents.
Disobedient to parents. You mean my mom and dad? Personal. Is it talking about men and their mothers and fathers, or the father and the mother of Yahweh? That's our mother and father. Your mommy and daddy, they're just a vessel that brought you into. That got to be realized. I mean, it got to be realized. Because some moms and some fathers aren't worth a lick. So that scripture don't apply universally. So the mother and father, we have to come to understand that that's Yahweh.
Right.
Both masculine and feminine. Now, if you keep that in thought, and you're disobedient to that which has given us this gospel, then you ought to be in line Not what your mama told you, not what you expect or what you feel, what your opinion or concept is. We're not dealing with none of that. That's the egotistical, misdirected personality, whichever way you want to spin it, because there's one gospel, there's one mother, and there's one father. That is Yahshua the Messiah. Now, we're going to run that guy all the way down through the scripture. Keep reading.
Unthankful.
Unthankful. Unthankful for the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Not using that which we've been given, which are the law and the prophets. Isaiah 8:20 says, to the law. And to, grab it right quick. I don't want to just purport my speaking as though I just a Bible thumper. Yeah. I don't want to just hear my story. This is not my story. I don't have to be here under by the graces of Yahweh that pushed me down here in order to help teach and edify a soul. And Isaiah says, through Yahshua the Messiah, being inspired by Yahshua, Yahweh our Father, says what?
To the law and to the testimony.
Uh-huh.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
And we've come to understand that there's no light. That light is an understanding of Yahshua the Messiah. Huh? Keep reading on down through there and see what happens if they don't speak according to the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah.
And they shall pass through it hard-pressed and hungry.
They, them men that we read over there in Romans, going to pass through the troublous times that Saul wrote about. They keep it together. I'm not losing continuity. Reading in Romans. That was Timothy we were reading, right? That was
right.
First Timothy.
Mm-hmm. Second Timothy.
Second Timothy.
Three. Yeah.
Three. Go back up to one right quick. Keep the thought.
2 Timothy 3:1.
Start maybe two.
Two. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud.
Go back to one. I'm sorry.
This know also that in the last days,
that's what I wanted.
Perilous times shall come.
Perilous times shall come in the last days. Now go back over to Isaiah.
And they shall pass through it hard pressed and hungry.
Hard pressed through these terrible times.
And it shall come to pass that when they shall be hungry, they will become angry.
What are they going to become hungry for? Just a famine of food? This is a spiritual age.
That's right.
And the present kingdom, which is now. And we're talking about spiritual things. We're not talking about your situation, your problems, your issues. It's satisfying and putting a balm on over it and just to get through the day. Because this day is the last day. And they're going to go through it hard-pressed. Hungry. We're not talking about a famine, even though the famine is coming, but we're talking about a famine of a spiritual understanding. True. Yeah, not just Ecclesiastes and a chapter here and a verse there, but keep reading. This is Isaiah.
And curse their king and their deities.
They're going to curse their king and their deities. See, that's all down here in darkness, not knowing who Yahshua the Messiah is. Keep reading.
And look upward for help.
And they're going to look upward for help because they don't know anything about the law and the prophets. See, the law and the prophets constitutes the whole book of the Old Testament, the five books of Moses, which we've learned is the law, and the subsequent 34 books, which is the testimony. He didn't say part of that. Isaiah is not saying part of the Old Testament.
No.
He's saying the bad, the murders and the killings that Yahweh had demonstrated all down through the time. You can't pick and choose. This is what I'm saying. I'm not saying Isaiah said it.
That's right.
By the inspiration of Yahweh. Our mother and our father said you got to use the law and the prophets. And yeah, they took down babies, women and children and nations.
That's right.
It's not a bad thing, neither. Because this was our example. You know what an example is? It's not the reality. That was a time then present. It's not their God. Yahweh is not beholden unto Jews only.
It's foreign unto the whole nation. He said right there in Exodus, the third chapter, when he received the name, the 13th verse, he said, my name unto all generations. So he's not just dealing with the Jews as though that was bad on Yahweh for having done that. Keep reading.
And 22, and they shall look unto the earth and behold trouble and darkness.
They're going to look to the earth. And there's going to be trouble and darkness.
Dimness of anguish.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall be driven to darkness.
Driven because they don't know the law or the prophets. But Isaiah said, by the inspiration of Yahweh, our mother and father, we should know. We should understand. His law and prophets, not mine.
That's right.
Yes, I can correlate. I can see how I experience something according to what I've been shown, but you got to come back to the scriptures in order to edify a person to see what the purpose is.
Right.
It was not my purpose. Back to Timothy, please. See, that was the rest of Isaiah 8 and 20.
Oh, wow. Timothy. Oh, that was 2. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
For men shall be lovers of their own selves, mm-hmm. covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection,
mm-hmm.
truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent,
mm-hmm.
fierce, despiser of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of Yahweh.
Mm. More than lovers of Yahweh. Or myself in my situation. What I've learned through what my experience has been. Keep reading.
Having a form of the worship of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
but denying the power thereof.
Mm-hmm.
From such turn away.
The power thereof. Now back to Romans, talking about power that is latent in man.
For therein is the righteousness, 17. Well, I'll go back to 16.
There you go.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
And we know, and we've been taught, that that gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection. And it's not just knowing that that the man died on the cross and he was buried and resurrected the third day. It says there, we read 1 Corinthians, is how.
Right.
How he did that,
yeah.
according to the scriptures. You reading all of this in the so-called New Testament. How many people realize that this is when he's writing Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, which give an account of that death, burial, resurrection, which did happen, but it happened in this dispensation. And to be made clear that that's what happened in this dispensation. Mm-hmm. Just telling a person that they know about a resurrection. They do that every year in April.
Right.
That's not nothing new.
Right.
But to demonstrate that that wasn't the institution of the resurrection, or it wasn't the Passover, and they don't understand how Yahshua comes to fulfill, do we know how to express it to a person with love and humbleness and caring?
Right.
I'm not mad. I'm just trying to be focused because there's something I'm trying to get across,
right.
and I know they're going to listen. I have no problem with that. Very clear. But understand that this is our Passover. Our meaning ours according to a spiritual age.
Mm-hmm.
Back yonder, they were set up. It was imposed. You know what imposed means on?
Mm-hmm.
Meaning you couldn't do nothing but that. So letting someone know that Moses is going to come up here and Elos is going to realize his problems and come back down, that's not what's happening. Let me rephrase that so we get all on the same page. You see? We understand this is the beginning of our story. This is what's been taught. And we understand that Moses was 80 years old when he came to this burning bush. It needs to be understood that he's 80 years old. Understand numerology, 8 means a new day. You follow? We got 7 days and seven ages, huh? New day, new beginning. This is one old day. Remember, you've got seven ages. The world was created in the day. They're not separated like this chronologically. This is all happening in the day of Yahweh. We got Moses, is according to Moses' vision. This is a vision happening in the day. And we can see and understand the times and the seasons in the day. And when we see that there's seven ages and seven dispensations, what comes after seven? A new day, a new week, drawn out. This is drawn out for us. He, as soon as he thought it was finished, over in Revelation, the lamb had already been slain. The lamb, we say the lamb was slain in the fourth. The lamb had already been slain in the realm of eternity. We're just role-playing this all the way. It's already finished. The day is done. It's for us to realize the truth about the matter. Mm-hmm. Right. That's all I'm expressing. Right. He said the lamb, Revelation, the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. That lamb had already been concluded. Mm-hmm. And to realize that, though, now, without a whole lot of fanfare and making up the story. It's real simple. He's 80 years old. He's going to start a new thing by giving him being Moses, a name. That name is important. That name was to be brought down to Egypt for Pharaoh. Meaning, he got the children of Israel. That's who he's already chosen. He promised it to Abraham. He said, to Pharaoh have I caused thee to know my name and my power. Pharaoh is representing the Gentile nation. Because he said, out of Egypt have I called my son. Is it just Joshua? He called the children of Israel. He was going to save them and bring them to the promised. That's a type and a shadow. Out of Egypt have I called my son. That was the 12 tribes of Israel. The family that's going to be brought up into this promised land. You follow? He said, oh, man, go ahead and grab it, Pharaoh. Have I called Pharaoh? People may not see that. They think that he's just talking. That's what a lot of people think, that this Yahweh is only dealing we say that that's only his, that's the children of Israel's God. And that would happen back then. And yes, Yahweh chose the children of Israel as a peculiar people to help demonstrate something. When he says he called out of Egypt, have I called my son? He's not calling just Joshua. He's calling the whole 12 tribes of Israel. Remember, Israel's name was Jacob, changed to Israel. He's calling his son out. Through his seed, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob is part of that seed. And when Jacob's name was changed, they came down into Egypt. That's still the body of Jacob. And that body of people is representing the son, who he's only dealing with at this time. But he's telling Pharaoh, when he says to Moses, you find it? Should be around
422.
Maybe that.
And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh,
mm-hmm.
Thus saith Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
Israel is my son.
Israel is his son. I just expressed that. Read.
Even my firstborn.
That even his firstborn, because he's dealing with the Jews first. Remember, after Pentecost, it was going to be to the at Pentecost, it's going to be to the Jews first, then to Samaria, and then to the other parts of the world. But here in the story, in the example, he's dealing with Israel first. Read.
And I say unto thee, mm-hmm. Let my son go,
mm-hmm.
that he may serve me.
Mm-hmm.
And if thou refuse to let him go,
yes.
Behold, I will slay thy son, mm-hmm. even thy firstborn.
Now, didn't he do that? He slayed the firstborn during this death plague. And he slayed his firstborn here when Moses fled up out of Egypt, too. When Moses killed that Egyptian down here in Egypt when he was 40 years old. 40 represents a change. We have a tabernacle pattern here at the door. This is our fourth step. It changes from this veil, this first veil here. When you go through this door, there's a change. Why was Moses 40? Because there's going to be a change, because Moses is coming up out of Egypt. You see? And don't ever let anybody tell you that he come up out of Egypt because he was a black man. See? That's not according to the story. Moses is not down here. Oh, man, I have to go all the way back to why Abraham was told to circumcise every Hebrew child after 8 days. And see, when you write down here, you can go back to this story. When Moses was born, a goodly child, representing the Spirit being in Moses for a particular purpose, Yahweh's purpose, not Moses' purpose. It was Yahweh's purpose. And he was put into an ark of bulrushes. And remember, that death is because there was a death decree. Talking about death, burial, and resurrection. There was a death decree at the time of Moses. And even Shipra and Pua would tell you they couldn't do it because of Elohim. See, there was love bestowed in them to not do what they were told to do by that Pharaoh. But nonetheless, the mother put Moses into an ark. True? And when we put him in that ark, he was resurrected out of that ark. That's a death, a burial into the water, into that ark, and then resurrected up out of that ark. Now look, Pharaoh's daughter, did she say, ooh, a black child? No. Never said such a thing. But see, if we change the dynamics of the story and express that it was a black because Moses was black in Pharaoh's household, you just disputed the whole situation when you're teaching someone something about this story. That's being blasphemous against the Holy Spirit. That's the problem. That's the conjecture that people want to put on top of a story that is already set. Why even bring up that conversation that Moses was a black person and that he had to get out of Pharaoh because it was a white household? Yeah, that's interesting, huh? Who would say such a thing, huh? Don't tell me. I ain't got a problem with it. I'm just expressing what's been heard. And see, you don't start out right. It's always been said, you don't end up right. And so if you tell anything different than what we've already been taught, then you're bound to have confusions, like it was read there in 1 Timothy 1. If you read it through, go get Timothy to make sure you were clear. And this is just one error. And it's not too hard to understand because it never talked about Moses being a black man in the Bible at all.
Yeah.
See, they knew that he was a Hebrew because of the circumcision. And that circumcision was how they can tell the difference. You follow? Not because of his skin color. But if you interject that, because if you think you're going to bring it down to the now, the here and now, the gospel of the Old Testament, and try to bring it down to the here and now, you'll rift with different personal opinions and ideas and struggles as though we were the enslaved people. You see what I'm saying? As though black people of now are like the Hebrew Israelites back then. Therefore, you can make that statement and what the struggles the children of Israel have because the black people have struggles now. So you're trying to bring it home, bring it down to earth, trying to come down. I get it. But you're out of context when you try to match it verbatim, because it's not about the story, because we're in a spiritual kingdom age that don't apply, that don't work. That's the problem of interjection, of trying to make what happened back here line up with everything that's happening here and now. Women back here served or pointed to a different principle than what women do now. Don't fit. Don't work. Yeah, you can bring it down. Bring it down real and home. I get that. We want to try to do that. We don't want to stay in the clouds, as it were. But see, you're going to have to come up. You're going to have to study. You're going to have to research. You're going to have to show thyself approved. See, Saul was made to be a minister of Yahshua Messiah. Isaiah 28:9-10 says they were made to run line upon line and principle upon principle and spirit upon spirit and 40 upon 40 and ascension upon ascension. But unless you can see that and understand that according to what we've been taught, not our opinion of what feels good according to my testimony, as though I've been persecuted as a black man and I have problems and I'm going to bring my story of what this is going to be. No, no. And I'll tell it too. It's in secret. Don't no one know. I have no problem with that. I'm just letting us know that that's what we coming creeping in. You got Timothy, 1 Timothy?
Yeah.
Just start at 1.
1.
Or wherever you can find it at.
1 Timothy 1. Saul, an apostle of Yahshua the Messiah, by the commandment of Yahweh, our Savior, and Yahshua the Messiah.
It was a commandment of Yahweh. He didn't have a choice.
Right.
As I say, I have my druthers, but I don't have a choice. As it stands this day, but keep reading.
Who is our hope?
It's my hope, too, that Yahweh keep me in the faith.
That's right.
Day by day. And struggles and peril abound, without a doubt. Keep reading.
Unto Timothy, my own son, in the faith,
mm-hmm.
grace, mercy, and peace from Yahweh, our Father, and Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior.
That's how Timothy's in the faith. He ain't running. Saul ain't bellyaching to Timothy about what he done went through.
Right.
Saul's not bellyaching about his trials and tribulations up to this point to Timothy. He's talking about Yahweh our Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah, which is the faith that Timothy has been taught through books, through parchments, through charts, as we've been taught. Keep reading.
As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightst charge some that they teach no other doctrine.
See, don't teach no other doctrine. See, telling somebody that Moses was a black man and coming up out of Egypt is a false. That's another doctrine. Now, if you don't understand that the circumcision distinguished the difference, that's something to be understood and learned. And evidently, there wasn't a problem because she went and took him in and still lived in Pharaoh's hospital for 40 years. But see, you have to understand, he killed a man. And it's true. Any other man, a Pharaoh slaveholder, wouldn't have been much of a difference. But that one was the firstborn of Pharaoh.
That's right.
Now, that's a problem. That was a relationship. That was blood type of thing, you see. It wasn't color. It was who he killed. That was the ooh, I got to get out of here.
That's right.
Wasn't this color?
That's right.
Come on, like you said, there was all kind of colors down there, right? But that's not that black color was that description of that. See, that's a fable. That's making it a lie of what we've been taught. We weren't taught that. That's what I see as abomination, blasphemy. Call it a small thing if you want to. But you're going to have to explain this to somebody because you can't keep it for yourself. We just said covetousness. We're supposed to preach to the gospel. That's what the founder said. He said, teach your people. And he said, he's building up a body of ministers to preach. Now, you can dub yourself and not a teacher. Hey, that's between you and Yahweh.
That's right.
Nonetheless, we're reading.
Neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies.
Need heed to fables. That's a fable of a man's personal, carnal opinion. And I don't buy it.
That's right.
And in his genealogies, who's who. And you can run down the names of the great teachers of the IDMR if you want to. None of them won't give a lick about none of them. Because we're only dealing with one story. One purpose. And it's not whether we like it or don't like it. It's the purpose. Keep reading.
Which minister questions rather than edifying.
See, I have a question about that. When the hell was Moses black? Where'd that read at?
Say that. Yeah.
Where'd that read at? You laughing. Why you laughing? Yeah. Where did he read at?
Miriam, he met, she is, was met with Moses.
She was
married an Ethiopian girl.
He married an Ethiopian girl.
And Mary was not happy with her.
We read. What Mary?
Moses' brother, sister.
Moses' sister.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll get on that another time.
So happy
well, she wasn't happy about a lot of things because it wasn't going her way.
Yeah.
That's covetousness. That's her own personal story. She got put with leprosy too.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she had to change her story real quick too.
She
was punished because she didn't like something. See, I don't like that someone's going to tell someone that Moses was black and come up out of Egypt. I don't like it. And don't grab their scripture to prove it. It said, but the law unto the testimony. But you're going to tell me that? See, that little thing is the little things that make people askew out the way. Keep reading. Saul tells Timothy the exact same thing. Read.
Now the end of the commandment is love out of a pure heart.
See, out of a pure heart of teaching someone about the true gospel of Yahshua. That's love. Not getting up on them, not trying to carouse them, not trying to have relationships. That's not the love we're talking about. Remember, this love, Yahweh is love. He's not acting like love, not giving flowers and not doing it. See, we're supposed to have Philippians, the first chapter or second chapter, which was read today earlier.
Right.
He talked about how the spirit that was in, have the mind that was in Yahshua Messiah,
that's right,
also being you. But see, Dr. Kinley himself said, you kick that man, you take that mind right out of there, because where's the mind of the Spirit?
That's right.
Yahshua is the Holy Spirit. Where's the mind at? See, people think that Yahshua came on down on this earth plane and he had a mind like me and you, and he's toiling and having problems with himself. He not knowing which way to go or what to do. Yahshua, he said he come at 12 years old. He said he's about his father's business.
That's right.
So he's not wafting and waffling like you and me, wonder and conjure and get depressed. That's not what Yahshua is. Yahshua knew darn well who and what he was doing. Therefore, Dr. Kinney said, kick the mind because it's a concept. It makes you think that he was just like me and you, wondering what to do. Wondering what the truth was. He said he's about his father's business. And he didn't change script that I'm aware of.
Nope.
He said he come to fulfill. He told John here at the River Jordan. Mm-hmm. He told the multitude out there on Sermon on the Mount.
That's right.
And he told some two boys after he resurrected on the way to Emmaus. He wasn't wondering what to do. He had the Holy Spirit. He was led by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, when in Philippians it talks about how this mind be in you, no, have this spirit that was in Yahshua Messiah also be in you. Because don't you know that we're supposed to have the New Testament written in our heart and mind, whereby we're led by the Holy Spirit and not our own? And when we get stuck on fables and vain genealogies and whatnot and wondering who's who, it just muddies the water. It muddies the water. Now, you can be corrected of that. We have no problem.
That's right.
Therefore, it's not a personal thing.
That's right.
But as Joe used to say, we can read a person's intent. See where they're coming from.
Mm-hmm.
Right when they get to speaking, what their intent is on their heart and mind, what they want to believe, how they see something to be, just like Miriam. Was mad at Moses for marrying an Egyptian, Ethiopian. She got her due. She got right in line, too. Put that leprous on her.
That's right.
You don't have leprous today, so how are you going to bring leprous down into today's realm? Oh, you got the virus? No, come on. There's a certain way we got to bring it down, but we can't embellish the story.
Right.
That's why I say be mindful, be watchful, try the Spirit. By the Spirit, and see it of Yahweh. Hey, this spirit, iniquitous, this is the spirit. You can't see it. You can't deal with the spirit. And you say you can't know spirit? Oh, man. Can't know spirit? Because spirit is inscrutable and incomprehensible. It's best that we can barely learn about who we are. Don't you know that you, Yahweh? But you have to understand how that is. That's why our aim, it says, the sixth aim, to learn, know, and understand. Now, I didn't write this. This has been in moderation for years, the aims. To learn, got to learn something if you don't know it. And you got to know it. And understand it. That's a big one. People know a lot of things, but didn't understand how it really is. This is an aim that we ought to be shooting for, not just give up. Ah, oh, hell with it. Today, black people, they have problems. They were in bondage here, so we was in bondage at some time. That happened 400 years ago, people. We got to get up off of that. I'll say it just like that, too. Because we're not dealing with a black or white thing. Yahweh is not a respecter of persons. You see, the second aim says to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah. Huh? The Messiah without distinction of race. That's me being African-American, Hispanic, Asian, or any other nationality. That's what it says. Nationality. Creed. Meaning however much money you got. Little money or a lot of money. We have some come in, don't have no money. Don't make no difference. We don't change the story. We may break it down a little bit further to explain something, but we're not changing the story. That's right. Sex. How many different sexes we got out here today? It ain't just man and it's not male and female anymore, because they're vain deceit of how they conjure up and how they feel. I feel this way. I feel that way. I'm not getting on nobody. That's their feelings, and that's all right. That's why we have a school, in order to help teach through that, in order to have some faith in Yahshua the Messiah. That's the whole, and that's Yahshua the Messiah, not my testimony. Caste or color. There go your color again, if you want to put color on it. And then back to number six. And to understand the operation of Yahweh's, don't say Yahweh Elohim in there. See, you got to understand, it's Yahweh's eternal purpose. Through the dispensations and ages. That means this chart got a lot of words on it. Ah, the hell with that. That's too much to learn. But then with the ages and the dispensations. Now, we have it pictorially illustrated here now. Not a problem. But you got to ask. You got to see how it comes down. It's got to come down. And you see how he down here preaching to the four corners of the earth. Why four corners? Because we see that they had to put blood on the four corners of this door. And we see that on this altar, they have to be blood on the four corners of this altar here. And you see this blood here and the two hands nailed to the feet and the crown of thorns. You got four points of blood. You see that? And you see this is a witness on earth about the unity of the Spirit. It's starting off with blood. And it's coming down through the ages and the dispensations. So I can run. We can run it either way. But you have to learn it. I just didn't get imposed with this. Because my whoever I'm related to, it don't work that way. I have my own books, and many of you know I lost my books. And I'm not happy about that neither. But nonetheless, it don't affect me because it's in my consciousness. That can be restored. And therefore, we can come over here and demonstrate the same thing. It don't change. The manifestation changes. From words to pictorially illustrate. That's what our founder gave to us to use. But if you don't point to it, if you don't understand how it works, how do you know according to the ages and the dispensations of Yahweh's purpose? Where's your testimony on these charts? That's the problem. We're trying to bring it down, but you have to know the story in order to see you that we're in darkness, and that this, when Adam and Eve, when they transgressed the law that was given to the man, and they came down, they lost their connections with Yahweh Elohim according to a conscious state, and that death brought death into the whole world. You follow? Brought that, we call it the initial sin into the whole world. Yahweh gave them 613 judgment statutes and ordinances. You follow? Mm-hmm. 10. 6 plus 1 is 7 plus 3. You got 10 again. Huh? Mm-hmm. And then now you got them having to try to follow those 10. And it was impossible to follow. Call Yahweh mean. Call them mean if you want to. But they were never, ever supposed to be able to follow them. Right. That was the purpose. Right. To make sin. What was the sin? Falling from grace of knowing Yahweh Elohim. This just compounded the problem. Huh? Mm-hmm. It compounded the problem until Yahshua came in to fulfill. Fulfill what? Fulfill the sin that made sin exceedingly sinful. But, huh? Perform. He performed 4,000 years of persons, places, of things. Those things have to be understood of how he fulfilled. For instance, how did he fulfill Adam coming from the Mother Earth? Just a question. From Virgin Mary. That's a fulfillment of seeing the principle of Adam coming forth from out of Virgin Mother Earth. That's a fulfillment. Yeah. But that's a fulfillment that has to be understood and believed in, and that's the operation. Elohim come forth from pure spirit. Pure spirit means untouched. Doesn't know what a virgin means? Untouched? Yahweh's untouched. He's inscrutable and incomprehensible. He's untouched. But yet he divested himself. He died. He come out of that state of perfection into a form. Which, why? He can't, so it can be perceived. This is spirit. But let a man tell you you can't know spirit, and you can only learn about yourself and know who and what you are, don't help another person. We're here to learn and know about Yahweh Elohim. Because as Yahweh said, he knew that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state. So it behooved Yahweh to transgress himself and come into a shape and form whereby he can be known and understood. You see? And we're reading over there in Romans about how we're going to do that until she gets back. This is the operation. And we went over it in the last class. And to keep rehearsing, when Moses come down into Egypt with that name in order to show Pharaoh his power and his name, you follow? Because why? Because the Gentiles are going to have to know it. They're going to have to know that name. And he's instituting it here by needing to know this name. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, he rose up in the midst of them and said, there's only one name given among men, and we must given among men. And by Yahshua Messiah, men are going to be saved. He instituted it back here by telling Pharaoh that by his name and his power that they're going to be saved. You follow? Turn the heat down. All right? And so we're reading here in Romans. Romans. Talking about knowing something about pure spirit. Or knowing something about spirit, not pure spirit. Excuse me. Okay. Because remember, this form can only be seen by divine visions and understood by divine revelations. That's what we just read in our sixth step, our sixth aim, to learn, know, and understand. You can understand by this form. And it says that this spirit, this that we can know of Yahweh, we can understand. How are we going to be able to do that? How are we going to be able to do that? Read.
Did you want me to pick it up at 19?
That's fine.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Oh, that which may be known of Yahweh. That means to tell me that you can't know spirit? That's a faux pas. That's not true. Mm-hmm. It said that which may be known, which can be known.
Right.
That's what it says, right?
Right.
People are going to tell you. Somebody will tell you, you can't know spirit. But we're supposed to be we're supposed to be ministers and learning that Yahweh, pure spirit, no, he's inscrutable and incomprehensible. But in this stage, in this form, based off of this tabernacle pattern which we've been given. And we got to be able to use the pattern in order to demonstrate to someone what they don't know. Everybody know everybody got problems. That's a fact. Mm-hmm. Me running down my problem to you is not going to help. This is the one problem now that we're looking to learn, and we have instructions by how to learn about it. How he say we're going to know about this spirit? Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto us.
Now that us is now that huh? Unto them. He showed it unto us based off of them.
Right.
That's why I say this is an example. Moses had to do what Moses did. Adam had to do what Adam did. Noah had to do what Noah did. You follow? Abraham had to do what Abraham did. That's all that's good and very. We don't have to change the story and say because Moses was scared because he was a black man in Pharaoh's household. That don't help nobody. It don't help nobody. Read.
For the invisible things of him.
Now look, there's some invisible things going on here too. Fifth aim is to extirpate. That means get rid of, right? Extirpate means to get rid of current superstitions. Hey, Moses being a black man and he was afraid and he had to come up out of Egypt is a current superstition. It's not true. What else is the fourth aim? Skepticism. Mm-hmm. Being skeptics and having ignorance. That's what we're trying to eradicate. That's in the aims. But if someone calls you on it, you just can't say that's okay. That's right. Because you know it wasn't the truth. But then it keeps the story going. When you embellish a lie. That's the point I'm getting at. And when you hear it, you ain't may not need a call on it. But you ought to know for yourself that that's not coming down how you've heard it. And how you understood it. Because this is a school. You can be free to ask questions. Keep reading.
Okay. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Now, clearly seen. This is what we want to clearly understand about this part of spirit that we can understand. And it's by this tabernacle pattern that was given to the children of Israel by way of Moses. And when Moses was admonished to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai, this here represented Yahweh Elohim. How I say that? Man is made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. Are we not?
Right.
How so? Genesis 1:26.
Genesis 1:26, and Elohim said,
mm-hmm.
Let us make man in our image.
Elohim said, let us make man in our image. Got to understand that our. Read.
After our likeness.
After our likeness. Not the real deal. It's a likeness. Just as Yahshua Messiah came in the likeness of sinful flesh, this tabernacle is in the likeness of Elohim. Okay, read.
And let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the cattle and over all the earth and every creeping thing that creeps upon
now
the earth.
Now, he's not talking about ants and worms that you can be able to step aside and not squish on none of them. You see, that's what some people do. Yeah. Don't kill an animal. Don't kill a snail. Back up. Trying to heal, try not to kill another fishes. And they feel really bad when they happen to step and crush on one. It's a Christian religion too. Nonetheless, we're going to say that Yahweh or Elohim is made by the pattern of the tabernacle. And therefore, we see how we are created. a head region, a chest region, and an abdominal region. And we have things in each one of these regions in order to what? Point to a tabernacle pattern that Yahweh, you got to believe it, told Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness and form this just like man. The boards and the pillars here around this tabernacle equals the same amount, 206 bones, right. I think, around here. You follow? In order to move this tabernacle. You follow? Just as the children of Israel had to move that tabernacle. Leviticus 16, chart at 1, I think. And so when we see how our head region is correlated to the most holy place, and our chest region correlates with the heart, the lungs, and this aorta artery that pumps the blood here, or that that the blood flows through, is correlative to the holy place. This table of shewbread correlating to the heart, the altar of incense correlating to the lungs, and this candlestick correlating to the seven-branch aorta. You see, these things are to make one come to an understanding of how we're made in the image and likeness of Elohim. Still has to be understood. And when we understand that this people had this tabernacle built, what happened when this was created? Leviticus 16:1. I think that's it.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered before Yahweh and died.
Mm-hmm. They offered, see, it was talking about here, this altar, the two deaths of Aaron, right? And they made the four primary ingredients here. They changed it. They changed it here. Nadab and Abihu, you see here in this chart? These are guys, go back up a little verse. I didn't want to get into this, but then we talked about it a little bit. It may not be there. I don't think, just start at one again.
Okay. And Yahweh spake unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron when they offered before Yahweh and died.
See right there. Aaron, his two sons, Nadab and Abihu, he's talking about. And they died. Why? Because they gave the wrong ingredients at this altar. The wrong one. That means there's a prescribed way in order to express the gospel. And if you embellish it, that's the wrong way of teaching it. That's a quick example. Keep reading on down through there.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all time into the holy place within the veil,
mm-hmm.
before the mercy seat, which mm-hmm. is upon the ark,
mm-hmm.
that he died not.
So you can't, Aaron can't come up in here all the time. Therefore, we're not always up in the clouds. You see? We're not always going up into this. Only a certain way we go up into this, and you got to know. Keep going.
Okay. For I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat.
Oh, I will appear upon this cloud on the mercy seat. Read.
Thus shall Aaron come into the holy place with a young bullock for mm-hmm. a sin offering and a ram
mm-hmm.
for a burnt offering. And he shall put on the holy linen clothes, and he shall have the linen breeches upon his flesh, and shall be girded with the linen girdle
mm-hmm.
and with the linen mire mm-hmm. shall he be attired.
This is how he's looking. He's going to have that mantle, and he has a certain attire when he comes up here the third time. But keep reading.
These are holy garments.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore shall he wash his flesh in water and mm-hmm. so put them on.
So he had to wash in his labor down here. There's an operation going on that the high priest had to do on the Day of Atonement because he couldn't always go up in here. Remember, we know he can't always go up here but one time a year, three times in that one day. Mm-hmm. And the third trip is what he's talking about, this special linen garments. He didn't wear the linen garments the first two times. The first time into the high priest and his family. The second time he had went into for the congregation. And then the third time is when he had to don the garments from out of this altar of incense and put them on and come up into here. And we're talking about that third time here. Read.
And he shall take of the congregation of the children of Israel two kids of the goats for a sin offering and one ram for a burnt offering.
Mm-hmm.
And Aaron shall offer his bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself,
mm-hmm.
and make an atonement for himself and for his house.
See, that was him for his house. That's the high priest. Read.
And he shall take the two goats and present them before Yahweh at the door of the meeting tent of the congregation.
Mm-hmm.
And Aaron shall cast lot upon two goats,
mm-hmm.
one lot for Yahweh and the other lot for the scapegoat.
For the scapegoat, one that was going to be let go. Mm-hmm. And not that's the Gentiles. As I recall, that's the Gentiles being let go and not being subject unto that regime. Because the goat that he kept dies. Read.
And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which Yahweh's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering.
See, he had to kill it. Because
mm-hmm.
that other goat represents the Gentile nation, which was going to be picked up later on. Because they weren't subject to the law of the children of Israel. This is the purpose of a scapegoat. Because Yahshua fulfills that scapegoat in sacrificing himself and putting that vestige of that on the cross in order to redeem us. That's why I say it's our Passover. Keep reading.
But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and to make an atonement with him and let him go for a scapegoat mm-hmm. into the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
And Aaron shall bring the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and shall make an atonement for himself
mm-hmm.
and for his house, and shall kill the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall take a censer full of burnt coals of fire from off the altar before Yahweh.
That's what we're talking about here, read.
And his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small,
mm-hmm.
and bring it within the veil.
Mm-hmm. This veil, the second compartmental veil here, read.
And he shall put the incense upon the fire before Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, mm-hmm. that he died not.
Mm-hmm. Because he had to come in infused with that cloud. He had to be, the high priest, that is, had to be inundated in that cloud,
yeah.
you follow, before he came up into this mercy seat. You're talking about the first time here. Read.
And he shall take of the blood and of the bullock and sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat
mm-hmm.
eastward. And before the mercy seat shall he sprinkle of the blood with his finger seven times.
See, he had to go around this altar here. You see, eastward, which way did the tabernacle face? It faced the east. And see, you're looking at it this way, you're looking at the west. See, he had to go all the way around. That way he sprinkled it to the east. That means you know that he had to go around this altar. Mm-hmm. And as it's been expressed, that this Ark of the Covenant spun around because the high priest had to come in between the two staves and they had to move around that altar in order to be able to throw that blood at the altar. Read.
Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people and bring his blood within the veil.
See, now he's killing the goat for the people. Mm-hmm. The bullock for himself and his household. Now the goat for the people. Read.
And do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock.
He meant he had to go back up into the most holy place and do the same thing. Read.
And sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat.
Seven times. Read.
And he shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel.
Mm-hmm. Now he's doing it for the temple, for the tabernacle. Read.
And because of their transgressions and all their sins.
Mm-hmm.
And so shall he do for the meeting tent of the congregation
mm-hmm.
that remaineth among them in the midst of their uncleanness.
See, this was in the midst of their uncleanness. And this is Elohim doing it work for them. This is Yahshua is going to do the work for us. If he's in you and you ate of him or learned of him, that's where that famine comes in. That we talked about with Isaiah. If you learn of him, then then shall he sup. He said, knock, and I'll enter in and sup with you.
Right.
So in Isaiah ain't talking about a famine of food. He's talking about a famine of understanding who your Savior is. Mm-hmm. He said life eternal is to know the one true Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua whom thou hast sent. This is how we're supping with him. And there's a prescribed way of doing that. Now we're talking about the third trip into this place. Read.
And there shall be no man in the meeting tent of the congregation when he goeth in to make an atonement in the holy place until he come out.
See, everybody hanging around this tabernacle now, they worry. Is there going to be at one minute, again, a reconciliation of that year for this event to have transpired? Read.
And have made an atonement for himself and for his household and for all the congregation of Israel.
See, we're doing this in a type. This is down on earth now. This is a migratory pattern. True? This is first heaven, second heaven. First heaven, second heaven, third heaven. You follow? Third heaven is eternity. Huh? This is second heaven atmospheric. This first heaven physical. You follow? And so when we see they're doing this operation, he went once for the people. Second, for the once for himself. Excuse me. Once for himself. The second time in the holy place for him, for the people, and the third time is into Yahweh, into the sanctuary, which is eternal, which is invisible. Therefore, if you see and believe that this is taking the a likeness of Yahweh Elohim, and they're giving sacrifices unto Yahweh. Because this is the atonement. They're waiting for the high priest to perform this third trip to see if they're going to be saved for another year. This is showing that Yahweh is saving them within this tabernacle. This is the likeness and the image. And just like we, in our consciousness, we're doomed, we're depressed, we're disoriented, we're not knowing what to do, but we know according to our understanding what we've been taught, what we've learned, what we know, and what we understand about the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose. This is his story. But this is how he converts our soul. By grace. We're not working up on my experiences.
That's right.
We're not working up on what I ought to do or what I remember I should have done back then. No, it's all according to Yahweh's purpose. And if we believe the report, that's what Habakkuk says, Ezekiel said, who will believe our report? This is the report of how we come in the likeness of Yahweh. You follow? Keep reading. Leviticus
18. And he shall go out unto the altar that is before Yahweh and make an atonement for it, and shall take of the blood of the bullock and of the blood of the goat and put it upon the horns of the altar round about.
See, they had to come back out and put that. He had to went up twice. First time with the bullock for himself. Second time with the goat. Now he's coming out of this most holy place back down into the holy place. And he has to mix this blood. And he puts it on the altar. Read.
19. And he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger seven times and cleanse it and hallow it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. And when he has made an end of reconciling the holy place and the meeting tent of the congregation and the altar, he shall bring the live goat. And Aaron shall lay both his hand upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. And the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities unto a land of forgetfulness, and he shall let go the goat in the wilderness.
Now, when we understand that that's had to happen for 40 years, that operation, in order for them to be atoned. Anything else right there so we can sum it up before I go on?
And Aaron shall come in, it's continuing. And Aaron shall come into the meeting tent of the congregation and shall put off the linen garment which he put on when he went into the holy place and shall leave them there. And he shall wash his flesh with water in the holy place.
See, he's putting that linen garment here in this altar of incense in the cabinet down here. You can read about that later. But keep reading.
and put on his garment and come forth and offer his burnt offering and the burnt offering of the people and make an atonement for himself and for the people.
Mm-hmm.
And the fat of the sin offering shall he burn upon the altar. And he that let go the goat for the scapegoat shall wash his clothes mm-hmm. and bathe his flesh the in the water.
Man. The fit right. man had to do that, read. Mm-hmm.
And afterwards come into the camp.
Mm-hmm.
And the bullock for the sin offering and the goat for the sin offering, whose blood was brought into to make atonement in the holy place, shall one carry forth without the camp, and they shall burn in a fire their skin and their flesh and their dung.
Mm-hmm.
And he that burneth them shall wash his clothes and bathe his flesh in water, and afterward he shall come into the camp. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month and on the tenth day of the month,
mm-hmm.
you shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you.
Mm-hmm.
For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be cleansed from all your sins before Yahweh.
And that never happened with the children of Israel, except for the one day, for that one year. And they did that for 40 years until that time changed at this River Jordan, which is the sixth step. And we know this sixth step is indicative of the flesh. And see, we rehearse these things that are in the law in order to give a person a confidence in order to see the operation of the faith, which is Yahweh Elohim, performing these acts. You see the intricacies of the high priest and how he had the structure and function in this tabernacle. In learning about Yahweh Elohim, there's no difference with us in how we're learning about the fulfilling of the law and of the prophets. And when we see how these things point to Yahshua, and when we cross that River Jordan or that flesh that we have to go through without a doubt, there's going to be he always says, who is the son he has not chastises? So you're going to get chastised. That's not the problem. Mm-hmm. It's understanding that Yahshua is going to redeem you through an operation. Right. And once you know the operation, that which held you in bondage, that which held you in bondage will you put under your feet. Mm-hmm. This is what that sapphire stone represents, or the earth. You follow? Made in the image and likeness of, we're made in the image and likeness of Elohim. It says in Philippians there, to have this spirit that was in Yahshua also be in you. We just said that Yahshua wasn't having a problem with where he had to go. Mm-hmm. And so we know that if this true gospel has shown us anything, is that Yahshua the Messiah wasn't instituting and was fulfilling. And we rehearse the same story in order for what? For us to go through our trials and tribulations, and that which we can endure and go through is under our feet, mm-hmm. as it were. The ontological, the fish that's swimming in the ocean, and the things under the earth. This is the things that we read in Genesis that man is a little bit higher of. Higher than. These are representative of thoughts of our understanding about the purpose and plan of Yahweh according to the ages and dispensations. When you believe that report, we're no longer endued with the mayhem of the doctrines of water, rushing water and waves. You know, remember Yahshua the Messiah was on as a was walking on, was put in that ship, and there was a tumultuous storm.
Yeah,
grab me plate 30 right quick. This is an upward operation, this plate here, 30. The miracles and transfiguration. Transfiguration meaning transfiguring from a physical into an incorporeal. Because this here This plate here, plate 30, is this plate here on this chart. You figure? Hebrews 10 and 5, right quick.
Hebrews 10 and 5.
Now again, we're going back to blood. We don't get off of blood. We're not going to get off of water. And we're not going to get off of spirit. We can advance and go into other aspects of it. But in order to get a person to see what Yahshua was, is what we want to know. Read.
Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire.
See all that we talked about in Leviticus just now, about those goats, about those bullocks? He didn't desire those things.
Yeah.
Those things weren't to be the forever thing going on. For those children of Israel for that period of time, sure. But for us now, we're not dealing with that. You follow? You can't stay there on earth. I ain't got a goat to give up or a bullock to give up. I don't have a yard big enough for none of that. So that's not it that we're looking at. We're feeding the information that Yahweh didn't want that. Why? Read.
My ears has thou pierced, burnt offerings and sin offerings has thou not required.
That's not, we're in a spiritual age. Read.
10:7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me.
Oh, it come in the volume of the book that's written of him. That's in Hebrews talking. This is Saul talking to the Hebrews. And we know that over there in Luke that Yahshua said that Moses wrote of him. I think it was that John 5:43 or somewhere. It says that Moses wrote of him. No, in Luke 24:25. I think that's what it might be, 24:40. Yeah.
Luke 24:25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
That's what Hebrews was just talking about. Read.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things this and to be, enter into his glory?
Yahshua knew this already. This is what he told his disciples. Read.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Moses wrote about Yahshua the Messiah, and Saul is talking about it here in the 10th chapter, the 7th verse of Hebrews. Keep reading that, please.
And they drew nigh unto the village where
That's fine. Oh, okay. Back to Hebrews. 10:5, 10:7.
Hebrews 10 and 7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O Yahweh.
Mm-hmm. Revelations 13:8.
Revelations 13 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb,
mm-hmm,
slain from the foundation of the world.
That's your death. That's it. He's slain at the foundation of the world. That's already set up. And that's invisible. We're talking about the invisible things of Yahweh. We're talking about the blood here. Matthew 8 and 23. Again, that's talking about the foundation of the world. We've seen that that's Elohim. He's fulfilling this.
Matthew 8:23.
This is John the Revelator read Revelations 13:8. Him depicted on the Isle of Patmos is looking at that lamb slain before the foundation of the world, that death. You follow me? Read.
And when he was entered into a ship,
mm-hmm,
his disciples followed him.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea.
That's that other gospel that everybody want to purport and put on you and think and make you do something other than what the gospel said do or what the report was. letting you know that Moses was a black man and he had a problem with Pharaoh in his household because of his color. That's a tempestuous sea. That's a raging water. That's the spirit you want to get. You know, is that up in the clouds? I mean, hey, that's what it's expressing. That's the gospel of many waters. Talking about a pure river of rushing water. You believed that once before that water was the gospel or gospels. When you got a tempest sea that's raging, not knowing what's to go on. And what happens when there's a tempest sea and you're not sure really what to do? What the disciples do? Because they're learning about Yahshua the Messiah now. That's what disciples mean. Read.
And so much that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep.
Covered with waves. That's the spirit. That's the water. Inundated in water. You got the blood that he was already a sacrificial lamb to be sacrificed. Now you got a ship. Huh? They're on a ship that's inundated with water, buried in water. That's your blood. That's your water. Keep reading.
And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying.
See, they can go to Yahshua the Messiah because this is the story. This is, they could do that. That's our example to go to Yahshua.
Right.
They did it back here, but we can't go to no man.
That's right.
Keep reading. We can go to our brothers. We can go to our brothers and ask, how does this work? How does that work? According to the Spirit. So they may show you love of what they might have learned according to the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. That's the love that they can impose. That's who you go to. Go to your brother. Not to some guru. Not just one of the so-called minister, as though he's going to save you from this temper's doctrine. Oh, I heard this the other day. How does that fit with our God? Yeah, you still in temper's water. Mm-hmm. True enough. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. Save us, we perish.
Save us. Save us, we perish.
And he said unto them, why aren't ye fearful?
Why are you fearful? When someone says something, it sounds good or they're nice. Oh, I like him. He's been around for a long time, and he don't really mean. Give him an excuse. You always say he's not a respecter of persons.
Right.
And to show the love, you got to be able to express it. I can talk here today because I know we're broadcast. I'm not saying this in secret neither. Go run, tell that. Go ahead about this rushing water, and they went to Yahshua to be saved. Mm-hmm. Save us, Yahshua. Read.
26. O ye of little faith.
You know what faith is? Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. That is Yahshua the Messiah. If they have little faith in Yahshua, and they're right there on the ship with him and can't see him for the lick of him. And now that he's gone, from a physical body. He's dwelling in the hearts and minds of those who preach the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, and you can't see it. Keep reading.
Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea, and there was a great calm.
He rebuked it. Yahshua the Messiah rebuked it. He had the power latent in him at this particular time. But Yahshua also tells the disciples, even greater works will thou do than in I. What does he mean by that? Is you going to go clean the ocean water? You going to make the rain stop today so we don't have to use an umbrella? That's not what he's referring to. He's referring to the thoughts and minds of the imagination of people that's going to come upon you with vengeance because they know not Yahweh. That's what they're going to come at you with. Like you or not like you. If you're not going to be in agreement with their doctrine, their every wind of doctrine, their crazy oceanic observation and speak. That's what the tempers, we're inundated in it now. Every known religion is purporting their information. And you can swallow up not knowing which way to go according to a conversation. We're not talking about storms and weather. That's Yahweh's dealing. We're just talking about the thoughts and minds that people put into you and you're not sure of ye of little faith.
Yeah.
Grab me John. We're there in Matthew. Just go ahead and grab Matthew 4:23. We got the blood or the death. We got the immersion or the water running line by line, right? Now we're going to hit the little spirit.
Matthew 4:23.
Yeah.
And Yahshua went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom.
Preaching the gospel of the kingdom, the death, burial, resurrection. Mm-hmm. Read.
And healing all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases among the people.
They didn't know how that worked. That was invisible to them. Besides the manifestation of people getting healed. They didn't know how that was done according to the Spirit. That's the Spirit healing the people. They saw the evidence. They saw the blind man blind, and then he became have sight. The deaf man couldn't hear, but then he had ears to hear. Why do you think Yahshua wrote that? It's to those who have eyes to see and ears to hear. Right. Not waking them up physically and literally now in this spiritual kingdom age. It's getting the report of that you need the death, the burial, and resurrection. You don't have to keep running the elementary chart all the time. You can use any of the 40 plate charts in order to run the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. And you can't tell me we know them all. Yeah, I can get the lamb down here and then coming out the 3-day journey to and through the Red Sea and the blood, the water, spirit. Yeah, we'll grab some other chart and run that chart down to me and show me how the Yahshua, the Holy Spirit, is operating through the death, burial, and resurrection. You follow? Mm-hmm. That's going to edify me. And I hear your story, but here's something of if you say you're a minister, because hey, Saul told us Timothy, you got a lot of teachers out here ain't teaching you right. Mm-hmm. And remember, when you're here, you got the 40-day, you got the 4-day. Take the zero off. The 4-day of Lazarus is in the grave. You follow? That 4 days represent that 40 principle here. And then you got this transfiguration on Mount Tabor. Give me Matthew 17:1. You got a death, you got the burial of them in that ship, you got the miracles. We're working by the Spirit, raising them and healing them of the sick and the poor and the needy. And Lazarus here being raised on the 4th day, representing your 40 principle here in this holy place. And now we're here talking with these three. You see, Yahshua Messiah is fulfilling. What's this transfiguration here that we're going to read about right now? It's fulfilling this transfiguration here in that was instituted, you see? And when we see how this was a type and Yahshua coming in to fulfill that with Peter, James, and John, James and John being brothers like Nadab and Abihu was, and Peter just being the elder, just like the father's the elder to Nadab and Abihu. These are principles we're looking at. And you can't run these things all the way down into the earth plane today and show me this happening. It has happened in the 4th dispensation. This is taking place. Matthew's writing about what had transpired. Read.
Matthew 17:1. Mm-hmm. And after 6 days, Yahshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them.
Now, after 6 days, what happened? Exodus 24:16. Comma or colon, right? And he said, and after 6 days, he rested. Just read here, after 6 days, he was brought up into a high mount, right? Mm-hmm. And showed, what happened after the 6 days? What happened after these, after the 6 days or the 7th day up here that Yahshua showed Moses? That was 7 days. In the second trip. On the second trip. This is happening on the second trip. This event here is happening. They saw the Elohim. You follow? They go back down to the base of the mountain. Moses sees this tabernacle and the creation drawn out from this tabernacle. Follow? In 3 steps. After the 7th day, and Yahshua rested, right? What did he see after the next 33 days? He saw the inner workings and how to put this tabernacle together for 7 days, right? Or 33 days. Start there again, first verse in Matthew.
And after 6 days, Joshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun.
That's what they saw here. Before this, they're seeing this transfiguration of this form, in this image, this superincorporeal form of Elohim. Read.
And his raiment was white as the light.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him.
Mm-hmm.
Then answered Peter and said unto Joshua,
mm-hmm.
Sire, it is good for us to be here.
Mm-hmm.
If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, mm-hmm. one for thee and one for Moses and one for Elijah.
See, he's going over a whole history. We know someone would be smart. I ain't got no time. They would be smart. They say, well, Aaron didn't see the tabernacle. True? Aaron didn't see the tabernacle. Right. They saw Elohim.
Right.
So he expresses a form of the three is a type of the fulfillment. But Peter speaking to Joshua, talking about a tabernacle, because he's seeing the vision expanded out. And after that 6 days, he knows that there's a tabernacle being built. Therefore, he has the audacity to be able to ask Joshua, should we build three? Go ahead and read it right quick.
Then answered Peter and said unto Joshua, Sire, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.
Okay.
While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, a voice out of the cloud mm-hmm. which said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased.
That's what they're having a vision of. Keep reading.
Hear ye him.
Yes.
And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid.
See, they're learning. They're disciples. They're not like this down here, Aaron, Adam, and Bayou, although they're fulfilling that pattern so we can see. But what else are we going to see? Keep reading.
And Joshua came and touched them and said, arise and be not afraid.
Now remember, up here, Elohim didn't touch them down here. You follow? So we're expanding this out. We're seeing more of what their understanding than what we see here that was instituted. Because this word or son here did not touch them. They only saw. Now Joshua, the Holy Spirit, has touched them, giving them an understanding. Why? Because they're going to need it in the day of Pentecost to recount and to remember to give the report. Keep reading.
And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Joshua only.
That's Joshua only, the Holy Spirit. Read. See, no man was there. Joshua is not a man. He's the Holy Spirit. That's what they saw. Read.
And as they came down from the mount.
What did he say?
Joshua charged them, saying.
Charged them. Tell you better not. Read.
Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead.
Oh, goodness. See, they didn't know dilly squat about what to say or how to say until the day of Pentecost. You follow? That's what we need to understand. And we got to rehearse this story so we can have a belief and faith in the Holy Spirit and his operation. Ephesians 1 and 9, I'll be done. Ephesians 1 and 9.
Ephesians 1 and 9.
I'll start up a little bit. I got a few minutes.
5. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Yahshua Messiah.
Already predestinated because everything happened. It was formulated in the realm of eternity. Before ever the earth was. That's what happened on the first age. You follow? It's depicted here on this chart in the state of eternity. Keep reading.
According to the good pleasure of his will.
Oh, the pleasure of Yahweh's will. Whether he kill an animal or kill a baby or kill nations, it's his good pleasure to do that. We can't bellyache and say, why should he or why could he? No, no, it's his pleasure. It's his will to be. Really?
To the praise of the glory of his grace.
And it's the praise to the glory of his grace, not my testimony. Read.
Wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved.
You're accepted in the beloved of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
In whom we have redemption through his blood.
And we can be reconciled unto the blood. The blood of Yahshua the Messiah.
And down through the scriptures, when you see the blood, you're being reconciled under the truth. Read.
The forgiveness of sin according to the riches of his grace.
Oh, that's sin. That, remember, the sin was already forgiven and nailed at the cross. But we're being fulfilled in the righteousness of knowing Yahshua Messiah. Because if you know not Yahshua, you're in a sinful state of not knowing, not understanding the truth. Not understanding my story, where I come from, and who my mommy and pappy is. That ain't going to do you a lick of good. My physical mommy and pappy, that is. We keep reading.
Wherein he has abounded towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will.
See, that something was made known unto us, which was the mystery of his will. Mm-hmm. And we got to stick to that mystery that's his will and know that history. Not say it's too much. If you know one little aspect, talk about that jot and that tittle. It's sufficient. But just don't say nothing to Yahshua the Messiah or embellish it with some old wise tale or fable. Because Peter says we're not looking at any cunningly devised fables. This thing was orchestrated and put into operation by Yahweh. And it's not a fable. Read. Where first you at?
9.
Yes.
Having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure.
Yes.
Which he has purposed in himself.
In himself. And you can know him. And he's spirit. He's invisible. Don't let no man tell you can't know and that you need to be down here on the earth. Come up. Realize the truth. That's the coming up. Read.
Mm-hmm. 10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times.
In the dispensation of the fullness of times. It says times?
Times.
Through the ages and dispensation. This is the dispensation we're dwelling in now. That would help one to know where you're at in times. Read.
He might gather together in one all things.
He's going to gather together in one all things. Yeah, this is all Yahweh. Hey, that's easy to say. My nanny used to say, everything is Yahweh. Yeah? How'd that help us all? All things are Yahweh. Even fight on the backyard. We got all kind of cliches to make the statement. But what's it mean?
Right.
Keep reading.
Right. In the Messiah, both which are in heaven and which are on earth.
Which is in heaven and on earth. So you just can't stay on earth. You got to come up into heaven and see the things that are being expressed. Read.
Which are on earth and in him.
And they're all in him. Read.
In whom also we have obtained an inheritance.
Yes.
Being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of this, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
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 This concludes this evening's lecture. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and from Sundays 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring your enemies and your friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, before glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and forever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Great class.